I would now like to call upon Dr. Krishna Kumar Valori, Director BITM, to welcome our guest with flowers.
Working with workers or talking to the sales guys. trying to understand the business ourselves, which kind of frustrated me a little bit, but today I realize that's actually a good thing that I did at that point in time, because we kind of knew what the business was, we knew, we got to know what exactly is happening in the market, and there was no Google at that time. We were not having any access to Google was there probably, but we never had an access to that. So, no mobile phones, I think there was no mobile phones at that point in time. So everything was book-based learning, and the learning curve was longer. But the time on office and the books was free. We spent a lot of time trying to learn what you can learn today in 5 minutes, probably. And we went on to learn. It was about 2 years of training period, and we kind of had a lot of time spent with the business, talking, understanding, and stuff like that. But having said that, this was not easy. Why it was not easy? Because we were asked to do a lot of work probably which we would not do today at this point in time, because it was very, if I have to put it in simple English, lower level, not very strategic, not very data oriented, data creation, putting things in basic Excel. Little frustrating though, but at that time, we never felt it was frustrating. But after that, it was becoming challenging because I moved on to industrial relations. And industrial relations, I can tell you, it's something where every HR guy should have an experience. Because it actually helps you to deal with human beings. That really helps you to build patience. That really helps you to understand a perspective of the organization and how a blue-collar employee thinks or how white-collar employee thinks. How do you really articulate the discussion? So that's when my job became interesting, and I put in a lot of time with industrial relations, I mean, negotiating with workers and stuff like that for about 5-6 years more. Then moved on to consulting, and though I'm narrating my biodata, I think what is important here is I'll share with you my key learning which happened in the last 9 years. And I started this company, which is called Renault Nissan Technology Center, without knowing what it is going to be, I ventured into it. So I was the first employee in this company, okay? And what actually is a learning there is the cultural mix. I started to work with a Japanese way of working and a French way of working. And for a professional, what is important, that's when I learned, and I would, you know, my suggestion to all of you would be, when you enter into a cultural mix, or when you work in a particular country, be it India, Australia, Taiwan, or any other country, let's say Europe, it does not matter how much you know in the management subject. What matters is what is the context, what is the cultural flavor of that particular company. If it is a French company, the way they manage things is completely different from the way the Indian companies actually manage. This is the learning that probably really twisted my way I thought. I thought it was pretty easy, but it was not easy, because if I had to select a table cloth, for example, or a table, which could happen in 10 minutes, it took us sometimes 10 days. Why? Because you have a French boss, a British, a Japanese, an Indian. We all sit together and think and discuss how it is, which color we should select. It may sound stupid to you, but actually I can tell you, it's a lot of learning, because the discussion moves away from who decides to why you decide. The discussion moves to what is important for the employees rather than who decides and what is the cost. Of course, cost is the driver. Because when you deal with a multicultural environment, what is important is never focus on individuals, focus on the subject. That's the learning which I had done. An individual could be a Spanish, individual could be an Indian, individual could be a Japanese, individual could be a French. And they have their own way of thinking, they have their own choices. But then if you get into discussions which are very individual centric, then the negotiations will fail. Now, if you want to really succeed in any kind of negotiation, me selecting a tablecloth or getting a agreement signed off, the best thing that I have learned in my career in this company is how do you move from an individual-centric to a subject-centric approach. Having said that, individuals should not, individuals do play a role in the whole process. So how do you really take into account which individual can make the maximum influence? So you should not get, you know, you should not rub that individual as well, because at the end of the day we have egos, you know. This mix will give you a lot of learning. Now, when the Renault Nissan as such is a very culturally diverse organization, Renault comes more of a French European culture, and Nissan is more an Asian culture. And the way they think, the way we operate, and the way choices are made are completely different. And India being in the center of the two extremes, we, you know, add to the complexity. Now, today we are about 6,000 people company, and at a time when we started, it was just, I was the first guy, we didn't know what exactly we are venturing into. Moving away from the culture, coming to an engineer, if you see any automotive engineering, what happens is, every automotive company thinks that their engineering, their design is the best. Any product company will think that they are the best. The way they work is the best, the designs are the best, the product lines are the best. But when you have a mix working under the same roof, what happens is how do you converge is a challenge. How do you converge the working styles? How do you converge these two cultures under one culture? So what do you have to do? You have to create a new culture. You have to create a new culture which fits both the culture as much as possible. This was one of our biggest challenges. So I personally studied the way Renault works, the way Nissan works, so what we call Renault Way, Renault Management Way, and we in Nissan we call this Nissan Way. So I studied both the cultures, how it operates, and we created another culture which is what we call RMTBCI Way, which is taking into account the best of these two, which are common, easily understand, which people easily understand, and created a third culture where both the culture actually fits it. So it's very easy to say today, in 5 minutes I could probably say this, but it's a long exercise because there are many stakeholders coming from two different cultures, and you have to do these buying-in of these stakeholders. This actually helped me to understand how you really negotiate when you are getting into a completely new dimension. When you are in the process of negotiation, the best thing is how do you put your point forward. The best way of negotiation is how do you really accept others' view. And that was the learning which I had experienced in this organization. And we kind of created a new culture. We now are kind of merging a lot of processes of these two different organizations where they have their own DNA of producing cars. So we are kind of converging a lot of working patterns, which is actually increasing our productivity at the end of the day. It is reducing cost, increasing productivity, improving our competency. So at the end of the day, if you are able to show to the business that any efforts that you take is improving productivity, competency, and reducing cost, they will buy it. They will buy it. And that was my learning. So I'm just moving quickly from my learning to what I expect from you, keeping in mind the future, because it does not matter what I have done in my career or what I have learned. What matters is what you're going to do in the coming years. That's how I see. That's why I don't touch too much on his feet, and I was never, I'm never convinced of talking too much of history at the end of the day. What is that is driving the future? There are few mega trends that is driving the future, and one of the mega trends is what we call the technology breakthroughs, which everybody knows. Now, what are these technology breakthroughs? For example, let me talk about automotive industry as I come from automotive industry. We are talking about autonomous driving. How many of you have heard about autonomous driving? So, in my opinion, all the heads should be up, because this is the in thing that we are talking about. We are launching by 2020 a series of cars in US and in some of the matured markets, the autonomous driving, which means the car should go by itself. What we call it is eyes off, hands off. Which means the car is going, I'm looking and having a chat with my friend, having a cup of coffee. So that's the way technology is moving in an automotive industry. The second what we call it is connected car. How many of you have heard about connected car or Internet of Things? Are you waiting because I said that? Anyway, just a joke. But Internet of Things is that will connect every gadget that you can think of using. From your bathroom doors to your house doors to your fridge to your TV to your car to your mobile, everything is connected. And that is what we are talking about, connected car. Your car would be kind of a moving molecule where you actually stay connected every outside the world. Outside the car, you're connected to the world. And that is going to be the future of automotive industry. Now, then we have big data, we have cloud, we have many things that we can talk about, keep talking about technology breakthrough. But what exactly this technology breakthrough is going to bring to the table for you guys? I'll touch upon that after I finish one of the other mega trends. The second mega trend that is happening is what you call the economic power shift. The economic power shift is happening from a Western world to the so-called emerging economies. For example, India, we are talking about China, we are talking about all the growing or emerging markets. Already we have more billionaires or probably millionaires than US or Europe put together. So what this economic power shift will bring, the power shift is directly proportionate to your buying power. Which means these emerging economies can actually put more money to buy more products. Now how does it really change the world in terms of business? So if I have more money to put on the table, I have more people to put more money on the table, it means innovation should shift from Western world to a emerging world. There will not be a world where you will see moving away a product from Europe or US to India and just localize it with some kind of a local engineering and then you say, okay, now you take it, I'll customize it for you. The customization concept will die over a period of time. Today it is there for sure, but it will die over a period of time because innovation will drive in these markets. I can tell you, for example, Quid is a car meant for India and from India it is going global. The car Quid was not launched anywhere in the world. It was meant to be for the Indian market. It was meant for the Indian market. And now we are saying we will launch a similar product outside India. Now these are trends of today which will be the way business will function in the future. Right? Now these are very important milestones that you should keep in mind. You will be forced to think in this pattern when you start your career. Now, the third aspect, what I call, is the demographic shift, which will drive the future. The demographic shift is, for example, Nigeria will become the youngest largely populated country in the world in the next 15, 20 years' time. Of course, India will be as well, which will be, I would say, 30s. But Nigeria will be about 25, 26 years average age. What this means in terms of business, it means all companies, you call it FMCG, you call it automotive, you call all kind of product companies will focus on these markets to sell their products. Okay. And when you deliver products in these markets, you need to really customize your innovation to these markets. So the way today a lot of companies are thinking, global companies are thinking, will shift from global to local. When I say local, is that country. You know? The shift in the way we think will happen. Now, having said that, these emerging countries, the demographic shift will bring a specific challenge. The growth will happen at enormous speed. When the growth happens at an enormous speed, what happens? You miss a whole generation. What does that actually mean when you miss a whole generation? It means people move faster in their career. So if you see 10 years, 15, 20 years back, the growth was supposed to be very linear. You start as a management trainee and you become a, let's say, director by the end of 55 or 60 years, stuff like that. But when there is a proliferation of growth, what happens? You move faster than your time. And then the whole generational experience actually misses. And that's where you have the concept of global mobility comes in place. Right? The concept of global mobility comes in place where you will have a lot of people moving from Western world with experience to different emerging economies, which is already happening. So whether you like it or not, whether I like it or not, global mobility will be the in thing of the future. That is the another trend which I'm talking about. This will be forced trend upon. So on the other side, you have the Western world where the average age is about 55, 56. So they have experience, they have the money power, a lot of companies have the money power. Nigeria, India, where you have young generation people, growth is happening there, probably need some 45, 50, 55 year age group, people who can drive some businesses. Not because we don't have, because we will have lack of those leaders. We will have lack of those leaders. So when you don't have leaders to drive, you will import leaders. Yes or no?
Yes.
Exactly. So that is called global mobility. This will drive the future as well. Now, taking into these drivers of the future, what will happen at workplace when you see such trends shaping the world? In the workplace, you will have a new social behavior, which has already started. Interestingly, what happened, you know, that day I was in a meeting room, and I just turned my face. There was a gentleman sitting next, and he was messaging in WhatsApp. Okay. And I turned the other side, the two guys messaging on WhatsApp, very in a few seconds, and they were concentrating on the meeting. So they, at one stage, they were fully engaged in the meeting. Not that they were not engaged in the meeting, they are absolutely participants in the meeting. On the other side, they are parallelly networked, probably personal or a friend or somebody, through a WhatsApp or a Facebook. Is this a good thing? I don't know. But this is the in thing that is happening today. And this will drive, these kind of social behaviors will be driven. Should I accept this today? If you ask me, I should not accept it. But what if you are forced upon it? How do you react as an organization? That is something that you need to do. Social media by itself is creating new behavioral patterns. For example, how many of you are friends in social media whom you have never met? How many hands are up? 10 years back, this would have been the most absurd thing to talk about. And if you really ask this question, how many people whom we don't know, whom we have not seen, but they know a lot about us? True or false?
True.
It's true, right? Just 5 minutes back, I was talking to your director, and I was saying, you know, he gave me his card. I said, sorry, I don't have my card. He said, don't worry, I know everything about you. We have done the full research. But it is, though casual conversation, but that's a fact. We are exposed to the world so much, willingly exposed. It is not that it's a scary thing. Yes, it's a scary thing, we think it that way. But we are willingly exposing ourselves, which means it is creating a new behavioral pattern in the society. And that will have a cascading impact in an organization. The question is, how do you really deal with that? Should you deal with that? This is thought for you people. You have to think as a professional when you're dealing in the future, when you're getting into the job, when you're going to get into a job, these kind of behavioral patterns will come. And this will create some social issues, or let's say, an issues, workplace issues. The question is, if you are in HR, how do you really handle it? If you're a sales and marketing guy, if your manager or subordinate is doing this, should you really shut him down, or should you really ignore it? If you have results, will you ignore it, yes or no? If you are in sales, for example, there, if you are in sales and you are able to meet all your sales targets, but at the same time you are socially connected, would you expect your manager to ignore if you're sitting in a meeting room and probably messaging somebody? You would wish to ignore, right? You would wish that he should ignore. Yes, sir. You will ignore, which means the contrary is you would wish also to be ignored if you are doing that. Yes? This is the world that we will be in. For sure, many of us would not accept this because we come from the past. For sure, I'm not from the past, I'm from the future. So, this, for example, another example let me share with you. This is one of the social behaviorists. Don't be surprised in the future for the HR guys. How many of you are HR? Don't be surprised in the future that if you are dealing with a virtual workforce, the question is how do you really deal with a virtual workforce? It's already happening. You have not seen an employee and you want him to follow a specific culture or a value system that he doesn't know. This is what I'm predicting. There will be a scenario where you will have cultural architects, specific. What is the specificity? Taking off from there, we are moving into an expert economy where you will hire experts. Even in HR, you will hire experts, you will have contract specialists, you have cultural architects, you have performance specialists, and performance specialists are not very the typical performance management, probably. In fact, I was in one of my discussions, I was talking to one partner from Ernst & Young just 2 weeks back in one of the IUs. And he said, I met somebody who wrote a resume. The husband and wife writes one resume. Okay? And they send this to one company and they say, we can do this job together, and this portion of the job will be done by this Mr. X, and this portion of the job will be done by this Y. And it is one resume, one salary, split into two. Can you believe this? This is an emerging trend of the market. The other is, I know a guy who quit a job and he's moving around the world, but he's doing small jobs by internet, making more money than he was making in one company. So what's the future which is driving to is one so-called employee would work for 5 companies or 6 companies. The question is, how do you write the contracts? So are you ready for it? So the agility, the way you think, will determine your future. I will never tell, in fact I have stopped telling people what I have done in the past and what is the expectation in terms of today's industry. In fact, I keep telling people, start to think future. Be futuristic, but be present in today. Which means, you'll have to be today in the place where you are, but be always ready for change. Because change is no more a fashion statement. Change is constant. You understand? Because change is happening every day. Every minute change is happening. We never know who's innovated something at this moment. So, from a... How much time do I have? Okay, I've gone half an hour. So, I'll give you more time for questions. My expectation, if I have to tell you, from a young workforce and the future leaders like you is, you have to always be ready for a change. Any kind of a change, even in personal life, even in professional life. Okay? So do not get worried about change in your life, because change is inevitable. Change is happening every day. So be ready for change, one. Two, the way you think is very important. Do not think past. Be solution-oriented individual. Nobody likes problems. Think solutions, always. See how you can bring a solution to the table, because if you are a solution-driven professional, your manager will always say, great guy, great girl, super. Okay? Two. Third, what I call the Guru Mantra is follow your boss. Because he is the one who will ensure you grow. So never fight your boss. All the leaders whom I have met in my career, I have asked them, what are the things that that made you a successful guy or a girl? They tell me about 10 things. Finally, they also tell me, I had a fantastic manager who really grew me. So I asked them, did you fight your manager? He said, no. And they really did whatever he said. So follow your boss. Simple. If you learn this mantra pretty well, I can tell you, growth is inevitable. Before I close my speech, last but the most important point which I would like to bring to your notice is what we call gender workforce. What do you say? The women workforce, diversity. Diversity again is no more it's no more a fashion statement for any company. If a company says we are diversity focused, we are so much percent, I say so what? But what great thing are you doing? Because diversity today, if you're not focusing on diversity, you are losing out in the future. Because this is a big power in terms of economics. It makes a lot of economic sense. Forget about the social aspect of it. It makes a lot of economic sense for women to be in your organization. There are 800 million workforce around the world which will be added into the global workforce in the next 10 years' time. And today we all know the economic decision makers are women. Okay? And once they are into the job, they add a lot of economic value to the company, plus the diversified way of thinking, because we are changing very fast as in terms of technology breakthrough or economic shape or power, whatever you call all the shifts which I have said, these forces will add a lot of value in the way the organization thinks. So, especially a message for women folk, don't drop out of your, of your job, your early part of your career. Learn to deal with challenges and learn to stay ahead of the competition. And never think that you are, a lot of people say, it's because women can't work, there's weaker sex. I say in simple word, bullshit. They are much better and probably more competitive or equally competitive than anybody else. So stay focused in your career. I can tell you, the organization will make the benefit. Plus, you will make the benefit. So it is not that you are doing favor to anybody. This is very important. We understand diversity is no more a fashion statement. It is the need of the hour for an organization. Which means you stand a lot of chance to grow fast in the organization. I will stop here and take more questions. Thank you.
Hello. Hello, sir. Good morning, sir.
Yeah, yes, sir.
My name is Vaibhav Piyani and I am from BIMHRD.
Sorry, it's too fast. Your name is?
My name is Vaibhav Piyani and I am from Balaji Institute of Modern Management. So I have three questions to ask you.
Please
My first question is the prices. That is Renault Quid and Datsun Radigo.
Sorry, I'm
not able to hear. Renault Quid and Datsun Radigo both were launched on the same platform with the same specifications and the features with the same base price, almost same. Then the Japanese are, I know all the technologies are messed up in the Datsun Radigo, but then also the sale of the Renault Quid is much higher in comparison of the Datsun Radigo.
So in terms of sales?
Yeah. And in the liking also, in the customer's point of view, preference also, the sale of the Renault Quid is higher. My second question is...
let's go one by one.
Yeah,
so sure. What is your question? It was a statement,
where,
not a question.
No, where Datsun Radigo lag up in comparison of the Renault Quid?
Okay, so good question. I would put it, it's a sales and marketing question, but let me put what I understand as an individual. I think it's just purely the customer's choice, you know. At the end of the day, today Indian customer like the Quid probably design more, or whatever this, the car, the way the car is. And so probably that's one reason which I thought. The second is Radigo is just launched, not launched at the same time. So it will pick up, or we hope that it will pick up much faster. Because it is under the, you know, we have not in terms of Radigo is more of a Datsun. So not, a lot of people actually don't associate that with Nissan. Actually, it's one of the Nissan brands. So maybe that could have, but I don't think so. I think it's more of a customer's choice. If you really ask me as an individual in terms of that question. If you ask me why do you buy iPhone 5, if you ask me, for example, iPhone 5 and 6, I will not buy iPhone 6. No, I have one. I would prefer iPhone 5 because that's something more handy, more comfortable. So it's a customer's choice. Sometimes you make one product which succeeds. Sometimes you make one product which is less succeeds. And sometimes you make a product which fails in the market but does pretty well in other markets. So it's purely customer driven, and Radigo is doing well, huh, for your information. Just that the numbers are not equal. Doesn't mean it is doing bad. It's not equal, that's all.
I read the comparison in one of the magazine, Autocar India, that's why I asked you. So my second question is, you see, Nissan launched the two cars, like Micro also and Datsun Radigo or Renault Quid also, in the lower segment of 3 to 5 lakhs. But the market share of the Maruti Suzuki is much higher. Like the top 10 selling cars of the Maruti Suzuki are only there in the top 10. So why they want to be in this segment? Japanese, why want to be in this segment? Besides, they know that they can't take off this segment because already Honda is there, but they have never launched a lower segment car. Then why they have launched a car in the lower segment?
Market volume.
But they will never be able to take off the Maruti Suzuki. They know very well.
You know, let me put it this way. After we launched Quid, our market share increased drastically. So, if you're launching, that means you're in the right slot, you're in the right segment. Today, we become number one European car maker in the country. And if I'm right, I think about approximately 4.5 or some percentage. And we are on the top 4 or 5, if I'm right, 4. People who sell cars. So we are in the right segment to sell cars at the end of the day. Otherwise we wouldn't have been there, number one, to answer your question. Number two, Maruti is present in this country for a very long time, and their number of dealer networks are very, 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 I would say multiplied by 5 times. So they get the leverage out of the volume dealership networks that they have, which for any new entrants, takes time to build that network. But having said that, with this existing network, if we are able to give a big challenge to Maruti, I think we are in the right place. That's what we think. Okay. I hope I answered your question.
Yeah. Sir, my last question is, there was a car of the Renault, Logan. So why the Renault stopped the manufacturing of the Logan? What I read is, Logan, this sold all the cars to the Meru, and the image of the car, which was like in the upper segment or the middle upper segment, was suddenly converted into an image of a taxi. So why it was done so? Where they lag up, they couldn't market the car very well.
See,
the car was good.
Yeah, that time you could see a Logan Okay, we came up with a venture with Mahindra, if you already see that.
Yeah.
I'm talking about 10 years back. And then we moved from that venture separately as Renault in this market. So we had to start afresh in the Indian market as Renault brand completely. So at the same time, when you launch products, you don't launch new products thinking, saying that I will not launch this one or that one. It's purely we do a market analysis before we launch a product, or we stop a product. Any company for that matter, it's not Renault, it's any company for that matter. They do a market analysis based on the market feedback. They decide a product lineup.
So why they stop the manufacturing?
That's what I'm saying. The point is the based on the market analysis. The market tells you these are the type of variants or this kind of cars will make a breakthrough in the market, and then you decide your product lineup. That's all.
You say that there were some loopholes, right?
Sorry?
There were some loopholes in the slogan.
Loopholes? What do you mean by that?
Loopholes means, I think, they were lying in some aspects like of the
No. See, for example, the world's best car need not be sold in a particular market. Why? Because the market would not buy those cars. Not because they don't have the technology or they have a loophole. Because the market wants something else. See, for example, you want to, let's say, you want to eat biryani. And if I give you dosa, will you eat? No. Similarly, the market says, I want these type of car. India predominantly is a B and A segment market. Predominantly. But that does not mean 30 lakh car or 40 lakh car will not sell because the volume will be less. So, any product company pitches its position. Where am I and where I want to position myself and what is the market share that I should be moving in the next 5 years' time? So, if I want to capture a 5% market share, what kind of product will quickly sell in the market or I have to bring quickly in the market that people will buy? So the amount of time and money and efforts I spend in rebuilding that product or trying to bring a new product, you know, these kind of decisions are taken. Once those decisions are clear and we say, okay, we put the weight around these kind of products, so we move forward in those directions. And that was why we picked up Quill, for example.
Sir, I am Arjun from Senior Operations at BIMHRD. So my question is that, given that GSTs already have on the process of implementation, and also the Karnataka government is against that. So
which one? I'm sorry, I didn't get it.
GST.
Ah, GST.
GST. And Karnataka government is against that implementation of that because the revenue will be reduced after 5 years.
I'm not a GST. I can answer, but I'm not a specialist in GST. Okay, go ahead with your question.
So basically, how will the as a manufacturing company in Chennai, in Tamil Nadu, so how do you look at it? Because if you implement GST, you will be having a good reach all over India. But then your local government is opposing that.
Okay, let me give you my perspective on GST. Okay, I don't want to get political here, but I'll give you my perspective on GST. GST is one of the wonderful things that government has initiated because it actually eases the way you do business. Having said that, many governments have their own view, many individuals have their own personal views, including people who are in the government or people who are outside the government or in opposition. They have their own views, right? And everybody has a right to have a view. So my view here is GST is a good thing, but it is also quite monstrous because you cannot move suddenly overnight without any operational challenges. So, if you ask me, is it a good thing? Yes, it's a good thing. As a manufacturer, should we go for a GST? I said, we will apply whatever the government says. Very simple. If the government says, apply GST, we have applied GST, you have to follow, we follow. So, we are a private companies. Private companies have no say in either to apply or to follow. We are here to follow the government's rules. And if you ask me, should we follow? Yes. Is it a good thing? Yes. I hope I have answered your question.
Good morning, sir. In the center, sir.
Hi.
Good morning, sir. My name is Preeti Oja. I'm from the BIMHRD batch, junior, marketing. My question is, sir, while the brand has quoted that by 2020, we'll double the share market, which is already increasing with like market share with the 15% after the quit. And then announcing that the next market we will be focusing would be South Africa. Means basically African.
Why market will be?
African market.
Oh, okay.
The
yeah.
target market. Why would we will go to the first African market?
No, not sure. There's a lot of potential. See, Africa is a very large market and you have a big potential in a country like South Africa, and that will be one of the place where every companies are pitching, a lot of companies are pitching, as it is a market where you can actually sell more cars. Now, having said that, your question, why are we first going there? We are not first going there. We are present all over the world. Okay, we are present even in Africa. We have Nissan operations, and we have operations in South America. We have operations in North America. Renault Nissan put together. We have in Europe completely covered. Okay, Americas, both South and North. Yes, Africa. We are present. We are present in Middle East. We are strongly present in Middle East for Nissan. Renault is there, Michigan. We are present in markets like Algeria, Morocco. We are present in China very strongly for both Renault and Nissan, Japan, Korea, India. So there is not many countries that we have not touched. So it is not the first market. It is one of the markets that we are present in.
Sorry, sir, just after announcing that we would double our share market, then it was the first, I just read it.
Double our share markets,
yeah.
I'm not sure we said that, but we have something called, for, let's say, Nissan, for example. In Nissan, we are talking about 8 plus 8, power 88, we talk. What is that power 88? We say 8% market share with 8% COP in the midterm plan. So we are, we have a very progressive plan. So if you really ask me, we are looking at this moment, we are targeting only power 88 on Nissan. Similarly, for Renault, we are talking about a particular market share and COP is 5.6 or something like that.
Yes,
I don't know where you read this, but I can tell you what is fact.
Hello. Sir, here. Hello. Sir, here. Straight. Yeah. Good morning, sir.
Still not
everyone.
Oh, okay, sorry.
My name is Sunil Kumaravi. I am from BIMHRD Marketing. Recently, in McKinsey article discussing change that will transform the auto industry, the sales will be growing, but the annual growth rate of the industry all over the world will be dropping by 3.6 to 2%. And one of the main factors for this has been attributed to sharing of the automobile by the buyers. So in that context, I have two questions. The first question is, do you think yesterday only Mahindra tied up with Ola also. So do you think for the automobile industry in the future, apart from the common man, the customers will be companies like this? For example, Ola, Uber, if the company is developing, manufacturing some cars, then they will be taking into consideration the companies like Ola, Uber, and any other taxi sharing services.
You need to say, if I rightly understand your question, you need to say like car manufacturers are tying up with these taxi companies,
yeah.
Then the customers will not buy cars, where they're moving to taxis, what you're saying.
Yeah.
I don't think so.
Okay.
Why? See, there are two things. Would you like to buy a car? So for sure you're not using taxi.
But the one thing is that, same question I have in my mind. If I buy one car, if I buy second car, then I will surely put it into Ola service. Share.
See, we need to understand why taxis are actually operating. Taxis are basically an emergency car. As a concept, if you see, taxis per se, when do we take? When we have an emergency, or when I don't have a car, or when I have to quickly go somewhere. For example, airport, where I don't have a driver. So we do not rely taxi as a concept for our daily use. Okay? Number one. Number two, whatever you do, taxis are financial burden for you on a longer run basis. If you are getting used to using taxi on a daily basis, by the end of 30 days, the amount of money that you will shell out of your pocket without even owning a car is much higher. Number two. Number three, human aspirations cannot be done away with. As a human being, you will always try to own something for yourself. Even if you use Uber or Ola. See, for example, I use Ola cabs when I'm in Chennai for some times, but that doesn't mean I don't have cabs. And if you ask me, would you like to use Ola or Uber, I would say yes. Would you like to own a car? I would say yes. If you ask me why you would like to own a car, of course I would love to have a car. I would like to go on long drives in a car, but within the city I don't mind using Ola. If it is giving me a parking problem. So the human aspirations cannot be done away with, and this Uber Ola is not going to rule the world in terms of an automotive industry. Automotive industry is moving into a completely new dimension. Where you are sitting inside the car, you are playing cards, you are playing with your kids, you are talking to your friend, and the car is going by itself. And you are connected with your home, you are talking to somebody, you are making conferences. So it's a moving molecule.
And sir, second question is related to this only. Actually, what market is segmented on the basis of like income, SEC, for example, people are not for the middle earning people. Is there any chance in the future that the market will be segmented like city-wise? For example, if I take it to consideration, this Ola Uber something like this. For example, densely populated areas like cities like Pune, Mumbai, where taxi services are used in large numbers.
Good question. The market will be segmented not city-wise. The market could get into micro-specific of individual-wise for all products. You understand? Today, that's what is happening. Today, what the companies are doing is all the apps. Today, if I say I want this kind of a spec, okay? So companies will go to an extent of customizing. That will be the future. They will customize to an individual way of thinking. Now, is automotive industry ready to gear with that? To a large extent, I would say it's a combination. You will have one big product, you may have some kind of a customization for an individual that can come up. Now, today, we have launched, I think 2-3 years back, we launched a car, S-Pass, where you can choose the way car should behave. For example, you like sporting, you like to be in speed, so you press the button, the car will, the engine will behave in that pattern. Okay, so you want some kind of a cool luxury, so things will change according to that. So that's customization. And it'll go into a new dimension of individual customization. That's the future.
Excuse me, sir. In center. So my name is Konya from BIMHRD batch. Just a general question. Sir, in the end you said to follow your boss and you can bring changes in the organization. So sir, how to balance between those
which thoughts? Sorry, I didn't get a question from
you. Sir, in the end of your presentation, you said that to follow your boss.
Yeah.
And on the other hand, you were like, you can bring changes in the organization too. So how to balance between those thoughts?
Okay, be ready for change or change, how do you handle change? Okay, good question. That's a good question, because if your boss does not accept change, and if you want change, and if the organization is pushing for change, how do you handle it? Good question. Okay. See, what happens when you want a change or you are proposing a change, let's keep it that way. You're proposing a change. What is important is do your homework pretty well on that subject. I'm getting a little micro now to explain to you. So when you do your homework properly, come with facts, come with analytics, and then give proposals saying that there are three ways of looking at this. Option one, option two, option three. Option one, these are the advantages and these are the limitations. Okay. Option two, these are the advantages, these are the limitations. And option three, these are the advantages and limitations. And I propose, that is you propose, let's say for example, option two. So you say option two because the limitations are less and the advantages are more. Okay? This is why I propose. And let's keep your boss way of thinking is option one. And you say the limitations are higher and the benefits are lower, and then you say this is what I propose. So when a boss looks at those kind of presentation, he has only two choices. Choice one, he agrees with you. Choice two, he disagrees with you. Agreed? So when he agrees with you, good, you are happy about it. When he disagrees with you, ask him any specific reason that he disagrees. He should give you a reason. If he doesn't give you a reason, he says, no, that's it. Okay, just follow him. Because that manager will not be long for in that company as a manager, because he will be eaten away by the competition. But if you follow as a subordinate, nobody will touch you. But you will have more opportunity to grow because you have learned both ways. How to present an information is very logical, okay? Even if it is very dynamic, what you are presenting. Then second is, how as an employee you have to behave. So that's why I always say people, move away from individual-centric to a subject-centric approach. When you move away from an individual to a subject-centric approach, growth is inevitable.
Thank you, sir. Hello, sir. My name is Monica Pitanya from BIMHRD.
Yeah,
sir.
Too many people around, so not easy to find you guys. Yeah.
Sir, my question to you is, while working in an organization, should we take success or failure related to a given project or task personally, and why?
You have the answer. The answer is no. You should not take it personally. Because when you become personal with anything, what happens? It pains. Yes or no? So when you take things personally, it hurts you. Your hairs will grow gray faster. Okay? We look older very fast. And if that is what you want, you can take it. But I don't think we want that. The point is, always take a failure as a step towards success. I didn't tell you, I'm a 12th failed. Okay? I failed in my 12th class. And I was the only guy because of whom the school lost its 100% results. Okay? But that did not deter my determination. Very interesting. I'll tell you my story, you can make a movie out of my story. Okay? And I did not get any admission in any of the colleges. 54 days, I stood in front of the principal of Loyola. Every day, morning and evening, he used to see me and he used to curse me. But I never deterred. I never lost patience. One day he called me, he said, what exactly you want? I said, I want admission. So he gave me two choices and he said, take one of this. And one was history. I said, history, no way. So I hated history and I took the other one. And then, by the end of the year, 3 years, I became one of the best students outside the college, and I ended up finishing 8 years in that college. The reason why I'm saying this, if I would have taken things personally, I wouldn't have been today where I am. So, in any failure, you should only analyze the reasons of failure, why things have not gone well, and what you could have taken things well, number one. Number two, the learnings you apply in the next project, that you don't do this, don't repeat these mistakes, so that you become a better person. And in US, there was a time, I think 2 years back, I read an article that a lot of companies were looking for CEOs who failed in 2008 crisis. You know why? Because they would have made them a better person to make a better CEO. So failure is the first stepping stone towards success. We have read that many times.
Because sir, we talk about a sense of belongingness.
Belongingness, okay, there is a difference between empathy and sympathy. Do you agree? So which one do you think we should attain? Exactly. You should see from other person's perspective. When it comes to belongingness, you have to see how do you really make a value in that job as a professional, but not emotionally. Avoid emotions at work. Okay? That's very important. If you take emotions at work, I can tell you, you will always be upset. Because not every time what you think will go through, and not every time whatever you say will happen. So it means it should affect me. If it affects me, I should sit and cry. and nobody would like to work with me. Agree or disagree?
Well, this was the last question. It was great to see you.
GST to automotive to HR. So good thing is, the best thing for a student, in my opinion, is the way you think. And you guys are thinking. So you need a good future.
Thank you, sir, for sharing your experience with you over national and international market and your insights over current trends, social media, women workforce, and importance of ethics and values. Hope we have such similar interactions in the future as well.
May I now request Dr. Archana Srivastava, Director in Charge, PIMN, to present a memento to our chief guest.